Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to promote and strengthen traditional marriage. I encourage you to sign up for our free e-newsletter at the website, which has information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. This is such a neat story. Dr. J is part of a panel at Notre Dame on the role of the Catholic Church in the cultural and political debate surrounding marriage. The discussion, Marriage, the Church, and the Common Good, was organized by Michael Bradley, a senior at Notre Dame and a member of the ITAF class of 2013. This story is also on our blog. Check out the show notes for the link.
Well, it's a pleasure to be at Notre Dame on St. Patrick's Day. I've heard about the Fighting Irish, and I wondered if there were any praying Irish. So I went to the Basilica for Mass at 11:30 and saw quite a few praying Irish. So it's a great pleasure and gift to be here on this occasion. As Michael mentioned, I am the founder and president of the Ruth Institute, and we're a pro-marriage outfit that struggles to present lifelong married love as an appealing option for people and to see the benefits of it. And so if you would like to be involved with us and like to get information about us, I have cards here where you can sign up, and I have a whole variety of materials that you can look at later. If anybody would like that, you can come talk to me. And I also have fully footnoted copies of my speech in case there's any press here who's interested in what I have to say. So my theme for this evening is how the debate over removing the gender requirement from marriage fits into the wider picture of the sexual revolution. I'm going to say a few words about how we got to this point and a few words about how I think we're going to end up if we continue down this path. But first of all, I'd like to offer two apologies. I was brought up in the 1950s. You all have no doubt been told that this was a dark time, filled with women in abusive, loveless marriages and men in dreary, conformist jobs. Now, I don't know what it was like to be an adult back then, but I do know that it was actually a pretty good time to be a child. So I would like to apologize to the greatest generation. Perhaps some of you missed that connection. Those dreadful people of the 1950s were the greatest generation. These are the people who fought and defeated fascism in Europe and who lived through the Great Depression without allowing the country to become communist. I want to say that my parents did not deserve what I did to them. And the greatest generation as a whole did not deserve what the baby boom generation did to them. I'm sorry for what I did to my parents and for my participation in the sexual revolution generally. And I think it's only common decency that somebody say so while there's still somebody left alive to hear it. They're dying off by the day, the greatest generation. I recently buried my last uncle. And as I watched his friends from the VFW and the American Legion saluting his remains, I was heartbroken to think of what we have allowed this country to become. If any of you still have parents or grandparents who are alive from that greatest generation, please thank them for me and tell them that I said I'm sorry. I also wish to apologize to all of you, the millennial generation. My generation has left you guys a mess. We've allowed a particularly destructive vision of human sexuality to dominate the culture. And I say to you, too, I'm sorry for my participation in the sexual revolution and for my indifference to the larger consequences of my own actions and the ideology that was developing around me. It's my belief that the sexual revolution has been flawed from the beginning. When I use the term sexual revolution, I have two main ideas in mind. First, the sexual revolutionaries hold that society ought to separate sex and procreation from each other and ought to separate both from marriage. Second, the sexual revolutionaries teach that men and women are completely interchangeable for all socially significant purposes. Any observable differences between men and women are socially constructed and evidence of unwarranted discrimination. A just society must eradicate all these differences. Do you recognize this worldview that I'm describing? Now, whether we agree with it or not, we have to admit that the sexual revolutionary ideology is extremely seductive. Back in the 60s and 70s, we all thought it was going to be great fun to have sex without having babies. Of course, now we're to the point where we're having babies without having sex, which I'm pretty sure is not as much fun as the old-fashioned way, but I digress. And we believe that believing men and women are entirely interchangeable appeals to some kind of sense of justice and fairness. But in spite of the appeal of these ideas, there's just one problem. Both these ideas are false. I was once in a debate on the marriage issue, and I made what I thought was a completely unobjectionable statement. I said, sex makes babies. My opponent argued with me. She said, no, it doesn't. Oh, what do you mean, says I. And she says, unprotected sex makes babies. Oh, I see. Well, do you see the problem with this, my young friends? Sex actually does make babies. And these little contraceptive failures keep popping up over and over. Right around half of the women presenting themselves for abortion claim to have been using contraception during the month that they got pregnant. And only about 55% of the most highly educated women in America will say that they're using contraception every single time. Among those with a high school education or less, only about 19% use contraception every single time. It is completely irrational to believe that you can build a society around the premise that sex does not make babies. This is not possible. Now, besides, sex has other consequences that cannot be entirely contracepted away. For example, sex builds bonds between the people engaging in it. That is why the hookup culture can be so disappointing, especially for women. We have sex with guys who would be a disaster to be in a long-term relationship with. Yet our bodies try to bond even with the creep. I'm telling it like it is. You want my honest opinion? That's good. It's the only kind I have. Okay. This is why marriage is the proper context for both sexual activity and child rearing. Marriage, which is lifelong sexual exclusivity and the whole sharing of life, creates a social expectation and a support structure to unify people for the lifetime. Marriage allows a safe place for their bond to develop and deepen. Marriage prepares the couple for parenthood, should any children arrive. Marriage protects the parents' common interest in their children. And most importantly, this expectation and structure defending the permanence of the marital bond protects the legitimate interests that children have in the stability of their parents' union. The claim that men and women are completely interchangeable is also false. Boys and girls are different in utero, throughout childhood development, and all the way into adulthood. The idea that men and women are identical has led us to pursue a vision of equality that is making us miserable. To take just one example of many that I could name, we expect everyone to operate in higher education and in labor markets designed for people who never give birth to babies. That would be men. In many professions, including academia, law, and medicine, people are expected to get all their education and establish themselves professionally in their 20s. Once a person is established, only then can they think about extracurricular activities like having a baby. Now, a man can easily become a father into his 40s. A woman, not so much. This form of labor market equality, which disregards obvious and immutable differences between men and women, creates a trap for educated women. We value our education and careers, but by the time we're socially and economically ready for motherhood, our peak fertility is behind us. Many educated women end up with far fewer children than they really wanted, or perhaps not even married. The sexual revolution offered us a deal. You can participate in higher education and in the labor market as long as you agree to chemically neuter yourselves during your 20s. And then during your 30s and 40s, you agree to undergo dangerous and possibly degrading and expensive infertility treatments. I say this is a bum deal for women. We've taken the labor market as given and adapted our bodies to it. I say society should take women's bodies as given and adapt the labor market to our bodies. Now, despite the fact that these are sophisticated and accomplished women, their misery is largely invisible to society. And so, most importantly, is the connection between their misery and the impossible ideal of equality and the contraception that makes it appear to be possible. I've coined a name for these victims of the sexual revolution, for their story is actually my story. I call them and myself heartbroken career women. Another corollary of the sexual revolutionary ideology is that adults are entitled to any sexual relationships they choose, and the children will be fine. The children must be fine. If the children aren't fine, we take them to therapy. We don't raise eyebrows at the parents and ask them to behave themselves or put up with each other's or otherwise pull themselves together. We rationalize the behavior of the adults and we medicate the feelings of the children. A friend of mine once said, every family has its crosses. Divorce is when the adults put down the cross and the children pick it up. In a couple of weeks, one of my Ruth Institute colleagues, Jennifer Teamy, will be here to talk about some of our new initiatives reaching out to the children of divorce. We at the Ruth Institute believe it's high time someone cleaned up the mess after that big first step of the sexual revolution, namely no fault or unilateral divorce. So I'm not going to spend too much time on it tonight. My point is simply that we've got victims, 40 years worth of victims, from earlier stages of the sexual revolution. Now, since the sexual revolution isn't making people happy, some people are going to object to it. But the people in power who benefit from the ideology will take steps to protect the ideology from dissent. So along these lines, have any of you ever heard about the Affordable Care Act's Health and Human Services contraceptive suggestion? Have you ever heard of the Health and Human Services Affordable Care Act contraceptive option? I haven't either. It's the HHS contraceptive mandate. And why is that? It's because the federal government is enforcing one view of human sexuality on every health insurance provider in America. No resistance can be tolerated. No accommodation can be offered. Not only must resistance be crushed, but evidence that calls the revolutionary ideology into question must be suppressed. But such evidence is going to continually appear because the tenets of the sexual revolution are false. The revolutionaries present a continual stream of propaganda designed to circle the wagons around their ideology, tamping down any evidence that contradicts it. I could offer many examples of this, but excuse me for a moment. I need to take off my jacket. I'm having a hot flash. I've been having hot flashes for over 10 years, but my doctor will not give me hormone replacement therapy because he says it increases the risks of strokes and heart attacks. But any of you college students here, young ladies here, went to the doctor for essentially the same hormones for contraceptive purposes, he would give it to you in a heartbeat without any questions. You might ask yourselves why this is so. The health risks associated with these hormonal contraceptives are so well known that the World Health Organization has classified them as a class 1 carcinogen, that is, a substance known to cause cancer in humans. But we continue to prescribe powerful and dangerous hormonal drugs to perfectly healthy young women. Those women whose health has been placed at risk or damaged by hormonal contraception are also victims of the sexual revolution. Now, you may have noticed that I have yet to say anything about removing the gender requirement for marriage, the policy that goes by the name of same-sex marriage, the reason that we presumably are all here to talk about. Well, that's because I think you're all intelligent people, and you can connect the dots for yourself. If the earlier phases of the sexual revolution have not worked, why would we possibly expect this newer and even more radical phase to work? And I think you can see for yourself that redefining marriage is a way of further institutionalizing the tenets of the sexual revolution. In order to believe that genderless marriage is desirable or even possible, one has to already believe that men and women are completely interchangeable, that marriage is about the desires of adults and not about the needs of children, and that sex is normatively a sterile activity. Most importantly, one has to believe that it is the business of the government to accommodate adults in having the sexual experiences that they want, that it is not the business of government to provide generational justice to children so that they can know and be known by both of their parents. One has to believe, above all, that kids will be fine with any configuration or reconfiguration of living arrangements that the adults decide they want. So let me say for the record, I do not accept it as normal that a child should be deprived of a relationship with a parent without a good reason. This is a structural injustice to the child. I do not accept it as normal that a child should move every other week, a fate that few adults would willingly endure. No matter how often this occurs, I do not accept it. Removing the gender requirement from marriage will not be the last step. of the sexual revolution. The next steps will include children having three legal parents, and increasingly there's talk about technology that will allow DNA from three biological parents as well. We'll have the breakdown of the presumption that legal parenthood tracks biological parenthood. We'll have the introduction of contract parenting so that intended parents of any number and gender will be given legal parenting rights. And finally, we will have the commercialization of parenthood itself, with surrogacy and the sales of eggs and sperm becoming normalized, routine, and even celebrated. I will never accept it that some people are entitled to buy and sell other people, no matter how young or small. I will never accept it that women are permitted to systematically and purposely create fatherless children, and that the law will help them in doing this. I will never accept that rich old men should be permitted to exploit young women for their eggs and poor women for their wombs. I don't care what the law says or how many people do it. And for the record, let me emphasize, I don't care whether rich old men are straight or gay. Third-party reproduction should be shut down, not regulated, but shut down completely. It is a violation of the dignity and rights of the child. It is no business of the government to give legal sanction to these kinds of arrangements. In his dissent in the Windsor case, Justice Samuel Alito observed that the court is being asked to choose between two competing views of marriage. And I agree with Justice Alito. And I would add that behind the two views of marriage, there are also two views about sexuality, the human person, and even our place in the cosmos. One view of marriage and human sexuality will drive out the other. They cannot coexist. The Catholic view is the major competitor to the reigning ideology of the sexual revolution. The revolutionaries have known this from the beginning. That is why John D. Rockefeller devoted so much effort and attention to bringing his Population Council and their ideas about contraception and population control to this very university in the 1960s. He knew he had to do something to neutralize Catholic opposition to his plans. Now, I realize that not everybody here is Catholic. Even at Notre Dame, there are probably some of you who don't believe in God. Perhaps no one has proved the existence of God to your satisfaction, and of course, no one can prove the existence of God, perhaps, or the non-existence of God. Just because you've never seen God doesn't mean he doesn't exist. So one way or the other, we have to make up our minds based on incomplete evidence. The Catholic view says that every child is a gift from God. The revolutionary view says every child is a choice, a problem to dispose of if you don't want one, and a commodity to obtain if you do want one. The modern world is living out the revolutionary view of sexuality and of the cosmos. We act as if we believe that we are alone in a meaningless and indifferent universe, as if we ourselves have no intrinsic value, that our sexual acts have no meaning aside from the meaning we assign to them, that our sexual acts are simply the actions of mindless particles bumping into each other from no particular cause at all and with no particular purpose in mind. In other words, the hookup culture is a metaphor for our beliefs about the cosmos. And the rich and powerful people of our country are enforcing this view of the cosmos and of sexuality upon us all, whether we like it or not. The Catholic view of all these matters is quite different. We believe that God loved the universe into existence, and that God wishes for us to participate in this love. We believe that the marriage between one man and one woman is a symbol of God's faithful covenant with his people. We believe that every sexual act is deeply meaningful, whether we recognize that meaning or not. And we believe that the human body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, not a toy, not a shell, not an empty vessel. My young friends, whether you believe in all that the Catholic Church teaches or not, you have a choice about how to behave. The Catholic Church presents a real alternative to the empty, pointless cosmos. At the center of the universe is a deep, abiding love. We are called to be part of it. We Catholics are not ashamed to believe this, and we invite everyone to accept the challenge to live as if we were all loved into existence. Thank you very much.
You've just been listening to Dr. J participating in Notre Dame's panel discussion, Marriage, the Church, and the Common Good. Check out the story on our blog, too. the links in the notes. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Robeck Morse pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.libsyn.com and iTunes, and as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love.